My name is Anna Dekker. I'm a sociologist and urban planner, and I'm here as part of a studio called Placemakers. Obviously, what we do is placemaking, and I'm going to try and introduce placemaking to you within 30 minutes. But like Rose said, if there's any questions or remarks, please don't hesitate to just shout, because it's a conversation. Next slide. Yeah. Well, like I said, I have a background in sociology, both cultural and urban sociology and urban planning. I'm here primarily representing placemakers. Also with me today is Karin, part of the team of placemakers. I'll just go to the next slide. Yeah. I wanted to start with a little bit of history. We're going to New York City in the 1970s. One of the residents of New York City was Jane Jacobs. She was a journalist and an activist. She became an activist. And her opponent on the left-hand side, Robert Moses, who was an urban planner of New York City in the 1970s. And this was the era of the basically the car, getting cities ready for cars. And the era of top-down planning and large-scale urban planning. And basically, the plans of Robert Moses were to demolish large parts of neighborhoods to make way for the car. So they literally wiped clean parts of New York City, including the neighborhood where Jane Jacobs was residing, Greenwich Village, and suggesting to replace that with large-scale urban plans where functions are separated from one another, so we live here, we work there, our leisure is here, etc. So a complete change of what a city should be, and also one in a complete opposition to what Jane Jacobs thought a city should be. She basically looked out her window and saw how her neighborhood was functioning perfectly because it was chaotic, because it was mixed, because it was small scale, and because people on an everyday basis were making that city livable and lively. So this is a classic debate that is in ways still going on today. There's still talk of large-scale plans versus small-scale plans, bottom-up versus top-down, etc. Car-oriented cities versus bicycle and pedestrian-oriented cities. And so, but it's important to start here because this is where placemaking started. She was one of the founding mothers, I guess, of placemaking. And even today, she's very well read and received, and she still inspires placemakers around the world. Like I said, she was not an academic, she was a journalist, and nor were the other founding fathers and mothers of placemaking, actually. So placemaking is not normally something that's discussed widely in academia or educational institutes like this one. Also because it's very context specific. Not one placemaking project can be similar to another simply because the neighborhood differs, right? So it's difficult to turn that into theory, but we're making attempts. So simply put, placemaking is both a method and a philosophy for urban development. It was, like I said, originally conceived of as an alternative to, at that time, the running paradigm in urban planning. However, it's becoming more and more integrated into governmental policies nowadays. The goal is to stimulate and facilitate that local communities, so the residents, entrepreneurs, organizations, etc., take part in urban development processes. And that, as a result, they take more ownership of their environment and then take care of it better as well. And in that process, of course, also collaborating with one another, leading to sort of social cohesion results. Some of its starting points, I will not get into all of them all too long, but if you want to hear more about any of them, please let me know. Am I blocking for you a little bit, huh? I'll just talk here. So first of all, it's a tabula scripta idea. So tabula rasa, as you all know, is a clean slate, a white page to start off. However, urban development never happens in a tabula scripta environment. Even a brownfield or greenfield has a history, has neighbors, has qualities and faults with which to start. So any placemaking process really starts with seeing what is already in that neighborhood and existing there. Secondly, placemaking is a practice that includes very many different disciplines, both social studies or backgrounds, sociology, psychology, anthropology, as well as spatial, so urban design, interior architecture, urban planning. They all come into play when we think about placemaking. I think the exercise that we just did is a good example of it. It's from very individual experience of space to how larger groups experience space and create space, but it also has to do with design and planning regulations, etc. So it's actually a very interdisciplinary practice. Like I said, the starting point is tabula scripta, so we're looking at not only the expertise of urban planners, those who have studied and have a lot of experience with creating urban plans and development plans, but we're also looking at the expertise of the end users, who are normally at the end of the process, but to take their knowledge and their ideas as a starting point. And their knowledge could simply be, I walk from this street to that street every day, and this is how I experience that street, for example. So it's very sort of common knowledge that's just left aside if we simply only listen to the planners who are far more detached from sort of everyday life in a neighborhood.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
You use the word we. Are you speaking from the role you have in placemakers as a we, or how am I to understand the we you speak of?
I don't know which sentence you mean, but I guess I mean placemakers as a team.
Okay.
Yeah. So.
Or from the discipline of placemaking, or I'm trying to understand where you're coming from.
Yeah, I guess from discipline as placemakers. Yeah, okay. Maybe that's the community I'm trying to represent.
Okay, thanks.
Good question. So placemaking primarily takes place in public space, and as placemakers, we consider public spaces as a really sort of important backbone of the city. This is where strangers meet and interact. This is where the city is public. This is also where there's a sort of has a democratic purpose in public spaces. This is our primary point of work. Last two, permanent meta. So that's the idea that the city is never finished, right? So the plan is always, of course, never starts from scratch, but it's also never finished. And often placemaking projects take on a sort of prototype quality where you test something in a small scale, measure the effects or potential impacts to then use that for longer term or larger scale development. And inclusivity, I know that this is a key word also in the evening, in the description of the evening, is something that you strive for, to have urban development processes be open to all sorts of residents and organizations in the city. And in order to do that, you approach different groups of people in different ways, in creative ways, to make it as accessible as possible. And I'll show you some examples of how we try to do that later on. We can skip this one. Yes. If you look at how placemaking can be defined, and we've discussed this with the group also when I was here, it's become somewhat of a container term. It can mean so many different things. It has many different interpretations of it. And I've divided that into two ways of interpreting placemaking. Firstly, is the sort of design and programming oriented perspective, so how public spaces are activated, so to say, turning a space into a place. And secondly, it's looking at the process behind that, so the participatory element of placemaking. And it's up to you, I guess, to decide what your definition of placemaking is, because it's fairly open still.
Can I add something?
Sure.
Project for Public Spaces, the mother where Jane Jacobs is from, is she says, make better places for people.
Yeah.
And I think that is important to add to the...
Yeah, I guess that would be part of the A understanding for people, whereas the B is with people and by people, right? And so turning a space into a place is really about turning public spaces into spaces that are sociable and that are people-centered rather than, for example, car-oriented. So I'll show you a few examples of that space-to-place way of looking at placemaking. Just to know that the difference between space and place in this understanding is that a space is simply the physical collection of objects and whatever is designed around us, so it's the tangible part. However, it doesn't have any social meaning necessarily, and it's often also considered as a passageway from A to B without any reason for it, and without it being any destination on its own. Whereas a place is socially meaningful and it's used and it's like a sociable place.
Can I ask something?
Sure.
Now you're talking about space and place as two different things, but are they, like, we are living in just the one word? Mm-hmm. So I think space and place is
the same. Yeah. It's for the understanding of turning one type of space into another type of space. That's why we use the two different words. Mm-hmm. But indeed, in common speaking and also in writing, they're often used interchangeably.
Yeah.
So if you're interested in this distinction, mm-hmm. you should use the two terms.
Yeah.
But indeed, you can also use them at the same time.
Maybe it could be also like house and a home. Like house is just like a physical place, and mm-hmm. home is like some sort of a
place. Yeah, mental and physical place. Right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
One that you live in a mental state, and one that a physical state.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So maybe the idea of placemaking is then to add more meaning to the space, right?
Yeah.
Kind of a function. If the place got a function, if the space got a function, maybe it is good to. Maybe it has a place.
A social function, yeah. I guess. Yeah.
Any kind of a function that you can put a label on it. But if it is like a passage, as you said,
mm-hmm.
it can be interpreted as a space.
Yeah.
But isn't that also very personal? Because a place can be a place for somebody, but also a space. So,
for others, right.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
With a different meaning for every person that experiences the place where
definitely.
They are.
Yeah. I think if we were to read all of these, we would all find that we have a different experience of that space, but that maybe we turned this space into a place just by doing this exercise now, because we're much more aware of our surroundings than we were before. Yeah. So I'll show you a lot of examples, so you can just go of what placemaking looks like. And you'll see, though, that the scale of placemaking is not a given. It can be very small scale, it can be very large scale. It can be organized bottom-up or top-down. Often you'll find that it's actually a combination, so it's either government-initiated or resident-initiated, but eventually you'll meet each other. And you'll see that it's both a design exercise and a programming, so organizing events, etc., or one or the other. But so you need, again, both disciplines.
Excuse me? That's also, that has to do with the city where you're in. In Netherlands,
mm-hmm.
The planned and the unplanned city work together, but I've been to other countries, and there is not such a thing as working together. So.
Yeah.
There's a difference in which country you are.
Yeah. No, yeah, that's a good point. Yeah. I'm generally, also the examples I'm showing, all of them are from the Western industrialized world. But actually, I think also even I was in India last year, and there's another sort of meeting of the planned and the unplanned. It's a bit like Jane Jacobs, where a planner might see chaos and unplanned. Jane Jacobs saw actually an organization behind the unplanned as well. But it's a good point. We're looking here at Amsterdam. Normally this is a sidewalk taking you from A to B. However, in this case, it's become sort of a gathering for the neighborhood. Simply, what are the instruments here? Food, maybe there's music, That's it. You might need just food to turn a space into a place. In this case, it's New York City. You need a table and a chessboard, and you turn the space into a place. It has a different significance and a different use, and it becomes a space where you can stay and enjoy yourself rather than just pay to be. This is a, skip this one, it confuses. Here we see an example. What was needed here, a lick of paint. And of course it's a bit of, there might have been people sitting on this stairs before, and there might not always be this busy, you know, but just to give you an idea of how it becomes a social space as well. This was in Amsterdam a few summers ago. Often you'll find that placemaking is used as a strategy for temporarily unused spaces. So this was a building site that was turned into a beach sort of social community space. This is parking day, using parking spaces and turning into parks for one day. This is a very small scale initiative. On the other hand, it was started as a bottom-up project, resisting to the car orientation of New York City. However, by now, it's parking day is organized by city government, and it's spread throughout the world. So that in terms of scale is actually much bigger. Car-free Sundays, we all know them. This is one of our projects I'll show you more about later. This is temporary cultural podium in a park. And another one of our projects called the Buurtcamping. So again, a park turned into a campsite for the weekend. Sports streets, this is. So again, turning the street into a social space for activity and sports and for the community. And here we have an example. It looks like a smaller example because the scale, of course, is reduced. On the other hand, we're looking at Detroit here, which is, a 5 or 8 year program of placemaking, where they use sort of acupuncture strategy of inserting small placemaking initiatives in different parts of the city. So it's a larger plan.
Who has taken the initiative in Detroit to do this acupuncture?
The municipality.
Okay.
Yeah. Often though, and this is an interesting one, placemaking grew very much so during the economic crisis here. And same counts for Detroit that went bankrupt. And so first indeed people took it upon themselves to improve their public spaces, but now it's become a governmental policy. Yeah.
I wanted to give an example of when you showed the park. In my country, in Zagreb, you have a big Jarun park, which is usually not used only during summer and stuff. But so it was not a placemaking initiative, but by people from the whole city. On 1st of May, it's a Labor Day in Croatia, and they all come to Jarun park to like set up their, let's say, living rooms and enjoy the day with their family. So literally people come the night earlier and sleep in sleeping bags so they can
have their spots.
Yeah, right. To have their spots. And then the park just goes alive, but nobody organizes. It's just a
completely self-organized.
Yeah.
But maybe this is placemaking.
Maybe.
Yeah, it's just a label, so these are more permanent. Well, these are on wheels, right? So it's very modular. And the last one is an example of it's a poor picture. An eventual permanent changed public space. So I think that was the last one. Well, skip. You get the idea, right? This is actually, again, New York, one of the longest running placemaking projects that I know of, at least since the 1980s. This park is being programmed and designed to be a social communal space funded by the businesses that surround this park. But you've also seen projects that are very short term, say like an hour, to some that are 30 years. 4 years running. Also, you've seen the light, quick, cheap, which is sort of a classic term to define placemaking. However, we've seen that it's also becoming also more longer term and more expensive, larger structures. You've seen projects that were initiated both bottom up and top down, and again you've seen design and programming. But of course, what you haven't seen is any of the placemaking in terms of the process that precluded this. So I'm now going to focus a little bit on that. Like I said, no placemaking project is the same. It's always very hard for us to sort of summarize what a perfect placemaking process is, because there is no perfect placemaking process and it's always different. So I brought one example with me that I hope illustrates some of the steps that we take in our placemaking projects. Just to the top quote there is from MIT, who published a report on placemaking, and that's what they're saying is a bit that A and B aspect. So both the design and programming of public space can be considered placemaking, but the social goals are just as central to contemporary placemaking. So let's just go to the next one. This is somewhat of a summary of the types of steps we walk through when we do a placemaking process. We start with a research phase, researching the location, the area, both the sort of the hard data and the soft data, so the quantitative and the qualitative. And the students have worked a little bit on that today, so we'll be back. We'll talk some more about that later. Preferably, we already try and do that participatorily. Next, we organize workshops or events or often sort of festive things to get stakeholders together and start envisioning potential interventions. Thirdly, the actual intervention takes place, which could again be a design, it could be a program, like the neighborhood campsite. And lastly, as a studio at least, of course, we move on to the next project and we try to transfer our knowledge and our ideas to a group of local residents so that they can carry on the work. I will go through all these steps again, and then it's fine. But then using this example of the project, it's called Pilot Podium Waterlandplein. This is in Amsterdam North, a park within a neighborhood that was redeveloped. So a lot of owner-occupied housing was replacing social housing, a lot of infrastructural and urban public space redevelopment. And one of the plans for this neighborhood was to create a new cultural podium, a 4 million euro plan to place a huge cultural center in the center of that neighborhood. And we suggested then to the municipality to have a test run first. So create a pilot podium to see if there's any need or interest in such a podium in the first place. So we built this. So just to walk through the steps, location research, we from the beginning started with collaborating with a high school, local high school, and a local music school. And we, along with these students, started researching the neighborhood. So we organized walking tours, they did street surveys, they had a little of desk research also, so looking up in social media what is going on in this neighborhood, what people think of this neighborhood, etc. Next slide. Yeah, this is an example of one of the things that came out. Next, we went to organize a range of workshops with these students, primarily with the students actually, developing a logo design with them, building maquettes for the podium, so actually working with your hands, organizing brainstorms for what kind of programming would be interesting them, and also promoting the podium. And so I think this represents how we work in the sense that when we invite residents to participate in an urban development or a public space project, we don't send out a letter saying, would you like to come to the city hall next week on Friday evening. Rather, we organize something or we go to them. So in this case, we have the students have built sort of pop-up research station, the interior you can see on the left there, where they ask passersby what types of talents they have and what types of cultural programs they'd like to see. Not by using a lot of text, but simply by using symbols, which is also an easier way for many people to express their ideas than using text. And here are a few examples of the skill model making workshops. Then the actual intervention, which was that pilot podium, a temporary podium, and again, a very, I think, important aspect of placemaking is to co-create in every step of the process. So we designed this wooden podium, and the neighborhood said we were insane because a wooden podium would be burnt within the next week, or it would be full of graffiti. However, the kids that you would expect burn the podium built the thing and painted the thing. So it's always interesting for placemakers to think of easy ways for people to participate in any type of building. Literally, I think the psychological effect of participating in that sense means that you appropriate it as your own and therefore take care of it. And I think that this podium proved that. Of course, then the podium was opened. We held a huge opening party with, of course, a lot of local talent showcasing either fashion, or there were rappers, guitar players. The choir, exactly. And of course, the idea is that the people visiting, so I were to know someone in the choir, but I would also sit next to someone who's there for the rapper, right? So you're mixing residents in that way as well. And so the podium, we ran that for a summer and organized different events. But of course, then we left. And it was important for us to transfer the management of that podium to local stakeholders. So we set up a sort of local foundation, asked local residents to take part in that, and we coupled each of them with someone from a local organization. So from the music school or from the high school, from a sort of social security organization in the neighborhood. So there were all sort of duos. And it's important, I think, to make it formal, really signing a paper that instates you as the organizer of this event. And so we help them find subsidies and to train them, I guess, in how to deal with volunteers and what types of programs work well that mix different groups together. So, nowadays, the podium is permanent. It's not a 4 million euro podium, as you can tell, but it's still there, and it's still also organized and programmed by residents. However, less and less so, and this is really an important lesson for us. These residents live their lives. One of them moved, another one lost her job and so had to quit. So it's really difficult. And a real challenge for us to try and keep that going even in longer periods of time. So again, summing up what a placemaking process could look like in the research phase, starting with that experience of space, user knowledge, start with what's there, so mapping whatever qualities are there, and also trying to do that research participatorily also really helps to get people involved in an early stage. Secondly, the co-creation phase, so involving a variety of stakeholders, so you approach children differently than you do the elderly, etc. So try and find creative methods to invite people to participate, make it sort of fun and make it easy. And of course, co-creating every step of the process, preferably also simply by having people painting, etc. And lastly, the transfer part, which is one of the hardest parts, but a very important one, to have a sort of longer term impact. I think that's it. Yeah. Thank you.